சோ அப்ப ஆரம்பிக்கலாமா சார்
யா யா
கிரேட் மிஸ்டர் கீத் இன் தி ஹவுஸ் ஹட்
பீ ஏபிள் டு ஆன்சர் யூ பேக் இன் தமிழ் தி தமிழ் இஸ் பேட்
பட் யூ ஷட் கிவ் இட் எ ட்ரை
நோ நோ இன் ஸ்கூல் ஐ ஹட் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ் யூ லவ் டு டாக் இங்கிலீஷ் அலாங் வித்
இஸ் இட்
சோ யூ நாட் அலௌட் டு ஸ்பீக் இன் தமிழ்
But
Tamil is the subject. I am born in Chennai. Correct, right? You can ask me.
No, that is there. But you would have interacted in Tamil more with sir, no? AR?
No, English.
Really? Okay.
He always spoke to me. Not once he spoke to me in Tamil.
Okay, great. Sir.
Tamil was a subject in school which I just mugged in script. Somehow I got some 40 marks and passed in Tamil.
Why was that, sir? Why was it? I mean,
I don't know because I'm come from a, as you know, I don't know, Anglo-Indian family.
Yeah.
You speak.
Yeah, English. I could pick it up from your accent. Yes.
So that Tamil was tough.
Great, Mr. Keith. I'm super super excited that you're here on the podcast, and I've been very eagerly looking forward to catching up with you, especially with someone who has spent a lot of time with AR sir all through his journey, and then 15-16 years or longer than that, 20.
You want to know the exact time, the duration? From 1990.
Wow. Right. Amazing.
I came to know him from 85, 86, 87. On and off, used to meet in the studios. Like, he used to play for some directors in the AVM studios in Chennai.
Right.
I used to be around playing with somebody else. Used to be programming or something. But officially, I got to play for him from the early 90s when he started his own stuff, doing his jingles and all.
Right. And since you mentioned 85, 86, were you involved in some shape or form with the album Set Me Free and all?
No, I was not in that. That was another bass player.
Okay.
He was a Kenyan or something, African guy, Jojo.
Oh, yeah, Jojo, correct. Right, I understand.
Fortunately, he passed away, but I was not in that because I was busy playing the. I was very active part of the hotel industry. I was playing in the 5-star hotels. So I was not known much outside.
Right.
Still, every night play at the hotel. That was my bread and butter.
Right. And how did you happen to meet?
Recordings used to happen. Then with some time. AR sir, I used to meet him. Used to come to the hotel for dinner sometimes.
He
finished.
Mm.
And then he used to hear me play and said, "Yeah, you play well. You like to come and play in one of my jingles." That's early 90s. So I used to go and play.
Wow. And then, was that Leo Coffee Ad, one of them?
All the Leo. He did something for Mercard, credit card. And for an ad club, he did something. Jayabharatham Furniture.
Which
I could remember. And then came Roger.
Right.
Chinna.
Wow. Amazing. So, I really can't wait to ask you or get you to talk more and more about all this. The best part is, Mr. Keith, I do not have any questions for you. So, let's go on a nostalgic drive. So I would like to hear the memories that comes to your mind, right from the jingle days. Let's go right from there, and then also transitioning into Roja and how things evolved from there. So, let's go from there, Mr. Keith.
So like I said, you used to call me for jingles and to go and play for them. That used to happen like every fortnight or maybe a month or something, jingle or so.
Yeah.
But you know what's a jingle? Jingle is just a 30-second touch.
Correct.
Maximum 25, 30. Just play some little. I say play, okay. But I don't exactly remember the date, but you know, somewhere in 91, late 91.
Mm-hmm.
91, early 92. I got a call from his assistant or some boy, whatever, boy manager. And I go expecting this, like, what to say, 30-second track I'm going to play on. Then I heard this full song. It's just a play. The baseline is your program on the keyboard. You know, I want to make it thicker. You play on that thing. Let's see what you can give me on this. It was obviously for Chinna Chinna. So I played them. I said, oh, but this is a song. I was quizzing myself and like keeping myself in the mind. What's happening now? Is it a movie or what? I don't know. Anyway, I kept quiet and finished. So after it, I asked him, I said, is it a song or? It didn't sound like a jingle. Then he said, yeah, I have the song. Keep quiet.
Yeah.
Don't tell anybody.
Yeah.
When you play, they just play. Okay. Yeah. I couldn't, like, I came home, I told my wife. I said, this guy I played jingle so suddenly, he's done the song. It sounds, I mean, he's going to really hit the Tamil industry.
Wow.
It's a beautiful song.
Right after that.
I told him, I said, this boy is going to become some big hit. Because later, 2 weeks later, I get a call and I'm playing Roja, Kadal Roja.
You used to call him Dilip or Rehman then?
Because
you've known him right from jingle days, right?
Yeah, I hope he doesn't mind me saying it. He's very strict about his name being called Rehman.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. That's the time he was going through that process of changing.
Yeah, indeed. Indeed. Indeed.
Yeah. Right. Rehman, because then I came to know it was, I would wear it in AR Rehman.
Correct.
So when I got a call for the next song, it was Roja.
Mm.
Again, another, my God, what a song. Again, that night I couldn't sleep. I came, I told my wife, I said,
wow.
The song, this boy did the song, I'm sure it's going to be a big, he's going to hit the scene. He's going to be a, I told him. You're going to become a big, big star. He said, I don't know. It's left up the one above, he said.
Yeah.
If he wills it. Said, no. My wife said, go to sleep. What are you going to talk in the night? You already come tired. I played at the hotel. I went to a studio, played that song at night, came back from 4 a.m. And because my hotel scene used to be from 8 to 12:30.
Right.
Next to play. So after hotel, he's calling me in the night to come to the studio.
Yeah.
Mm.
Wow.
But then, it's to be honest. I had a cycle.
Oh, yeah?
Put my guitar and he used to say, come on, your iron horse. Yes, yeah. That's all. Then after, rest was, I didn't know what to say. It all happened. Then songs were coming in. Then the re-recording of Roja and Pudhiya Mugam.
Yeah.
By the time he finished Pudhiya Mugam, he got the national award for Roja.
Oh, wow.
92 and he got.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, right after
that. So the movie was released, big hit.
Yes. Right, and did you tell him then? See, I told you.
Yes, exactly. See, I told you. Okay. So that then came Pudhiya Mugam.
Yeah.
So then it was going on. Then he said, I used to play at the hotel. Then he said, because then his timing started changing. Earlier, I forgot to mention. When he used to call me, tell him, call me only on a Monday.
Oh.
Because Monday used to be my off.
Right.
So I can go and play.
Correct.
Because with him, you have to wait. You know, he's composing. And then he says, yeah, play. Wait long hours. But then when this movie thing started happening, he couldn't. He used to call me erratic. And he'll call me on a Saturday or he'll call me on a Wednesday or a Friday. I tell his band at 8 o'clock, I have to leave because 8:30, I have to be in the hotel.
Correct.
But that will not happen. And then I'll get late. I'll be playing. The hotel people will be waiting. The other guys in the band, no bass player in the band. The hotel, you have to start at 8:30. So, I'll be rushing. He said, oh God, you have to go. No, okay, just go and come back. Then he said, why did you quit the hotel, sir? Join this side. But are you not sure? No, I have family, man, daughter. Hotel was like some steady income coming. I couldn't depend on recordings. It was a regular salary. Yeah.
Okay.
So I was a little bit skeptical. Then I might leave the hotel scene and join the studio where I don't know how much work will I get.
Correct.
That thing was, I signed a contract for every 6 months you have to play. So we You can't break the contract. I mean, all those, yeah.
Oh, wow.
All the funders, all those things. Red tape. You can't inform the band, the leader. You have to take 2 months in advance, find the replacement.
Wow.
I'm talking in 91.
Correct.
Samoa used to go by Delhi. Then he said, Safi, he'll come in the morning. Then finally, I had to quit the hotel because then by 95, he was like flying.
Yeah.
Movies. Yeah, get ready, man. We're going to do some live shows. And so I hope you leave that hotel. I said, yes, I'm leaving the hotel. And then I told my band leader and said, I told him 5 months. I said, you 5 months. Somewhere in September or something. October, November, December. Yeah. Somewhere in August. I said, December 31st, 94 will be my last gig at this hotel. Right. 95, January 1st, please find a new base there. They said, okay. We'll have to find what.
Yes.
I said, I'm getting a little busy. But then by the time also, other music directors are coming. No? After Rahman came, like Suresh Peters and Yuvan Shankar Raja. So then all the people calling me. By that time, I was only bass player around. There's no competition for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was being called left, right, and center. The work was good. I told my wife, I'm leaving. God has blessed us. And I told him, he said, Abba. He said, thank God he left us. That is that. Yeah. Then that's all. That's till now, I've been busy in this film industry.
So just wanting to know, obviously, let's take Roja, for example, or Pudhimugam, any of the movies that you work with, sir. What I wanted to know is, you usually get the notations, is it? Is that how he gives you beforehand, saying, this is how I need it? And then you play based on that? Or it's usually a jamming session between the two of you, and then you arrive at that sweet spot?
No, not that way, actually. He always calls me when he's mixing the song, at the final stage of the song.
Oh, okay.
Because at that time, he would have played a keyboard bass or a... It's a track bass. On the... While mixing, if he finds that not sounding too good or live enough or not supporting the track, then is the time he will call me.
Right.
So, most of the time, I'll be... 50% of the recordings, I'll play a line which he has already played. It's only 50%. He may want me to replicate the bass line to make it sound fatter or something.
Yeah.
But most of the time, he immediately takes up the bass, says, come on, you play now. No notes, no notation, nothing.
I understand.
Yeah, he just said, play.
Right.
And yeah, I'll just play. He'll be smiling and saying, a very good person to work with. Never, he's always smiling. Good. But I think you can play one more. You can play better. You smile and get the work out of it. But good.
Beautiful. And
great also, fun.
Yeah, indeed. Also something that I've been wanting to ask you is, you know, not just particularly about Sir, but working with music directors from down south in general, will usually have some element of a Carnatic influence in their composition with the ragas and things like that. Now, you come here as a bass guitarist and you have to adapt to the South Indian way of
Correct.
Composing. So how do you go about doing that? It's obviously naturally a shift for you from the way you think and the way you play, right?
Yeah, see, I was always open to learning.
Right.
Like, I had this privilege of playing I got used to this Carnatic thing. You know?
Mm.
I had the opportunity of playing with these two brothers, you know, Ganesh and Kumbresh.
Yeah. Correct.
I used to play a lot, and the guitar is called Prasanna.
Correct. He's coming next.
He played on July Madam.
So
I used to play a lot with them, bring Carnatic fusion concerts with them.
Yeah.
So that's how I came to learn a little about this Carnatic stuff. And I was always eager to learn. By playing their music, I used to ask them, okay, what's the name of this rag? And they'll tell me. And then I'll adapt it. Is it funny? The notes are almost same with the Western music notes.
Wow. Wow.
So during rehearsal, I sit down and listen and write and play and adapt myself. I used to adapt to myself.
Right,
Plug in and plug out. And I'm doing a Western gig, I plug in and do my Western. And doing a Carnatic, I unplug from the Western world and get into the Carnatic.
Wow, beautiful.
That is so.
So you basically learned it while on the job.
While on the job. I didn't take a formal training or something.
Yeah.
Carnatic. I used to learn it. And rag. Rag is an equivalent name of a scale in Western music.
Correct.
Sa, we say do. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, di, do, sa, re, ga, ma, pa, da, ni, sa.
Yeah, yeah.
So I used to depict it and write it down and get it.
Right. Wow. Mm-hmm. I find this very fascinating. Okay, so that's it. I mean, yeah, sorry, keep going.
No, and these guys are also very good to teach me now that they explain to me. Ganesh Kumari, Prasanna, the Selva Ganesh. Yeah, good.
And anything from a Carnatic perspective, any of the songs that you would have played with Sir comes to your mind? Any of the memories?
Yeah, Julai Madam was like,
yeah,
Carnatic rag.
Yeah.
More, I don't know exactly the what's the rag. So I think more harmonic minor, Kirwani.
Yeah, yeah.
So I learned, and yeah, there was some line he also wanted me to play with Prasanna. I played, so yeah, I listen carefully and learn it and
understand. Understand. Yeah. And so, of course, you started off playing for him, and then the concert tours also started to happen. So what was it like to perform with him in a live concert? Because it's obviously different from performing or playing within a studio, right?
Correct. Yeah.
And
studio what, and...
Yeah.
Studio and a live show are two different disciplines altogether. Yeah, live show is a very great experience. First of all, playing with a big orchestra and the setup and the rehearsals and everything is involved. It's what shall I say if I'm doing the right now? It's also painstaking because he was a taskmaster and a perfectionist. He wanted everything to be perfect.
Correct.
I wouldn't say a taskmaster. More perfectionist. Everything should be paka. So when you're having a show, means at least 1 month in advance, rehearsals will be happening.
Yeah.
So the song repertoire itself will be like say 30 to 40 songs.
Correct.
So you'll want all the musicians to get the right parts right first.
Yeah.
So we get together, there used to be this violins conductor for strings.
Yeah.
Gentleman called Mr. Srinivas Murthy.
Oh, yes.
He'll be in charge of the string section and the other musicians who are available.
Okay, great. Nice one.
Are you a musician too?
I wish. Hopefully one day I am, but I'm not. I can see
a guitar there.
Yeah. I got myself a guitar to learn how to play a guitar, but the best part is I only had two classes. And you might know Alphonse Joseph from the Kerala music industry. He's a singer.
Alphonse Joseph. Malayali guy.
Yeah. He taught me two classes. And then after that, he didn't find time and I didn't find time. So I'm not a musician.
Okay.
But I want to get back to the Carnatic part, Keith. I'm very impressed and then fascinated the way you shift into playing Carnatic from a Western
background.
Right? And then, so just wondering, can you play something in Carnatic? Just play anything in Carnatic.
Okay, this is my D minor scale.
Oh, wow.
It's in Western, it is called harmonic minor. Okay. The scale. On the Western side, we use it, call it the harmonic minor. And the guys or the composers employ its notes, they call scale degrees, which are the notes. And compose tune. In Carnatic music, it is called Kirwani.
Correct.
the Carnatic name.
Yeah.
Western, in the Western way, we would play it more smoothly like this. I would play a bass pattern. I would... But in Carnatic, they employ this thing called gamakas and all.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So they...
Wow.
So I used to adapt myself by watching these guys playing in person.
Wow.
But my job, again, they don't play the full Carnatic style.
Yeah.
And because we are playing music which is called fusion.
Yeah.
So when the fusion part comes, the obvious fusion is when you're fusing the Western and the Carnatic.
Yeah.
So I'd be playing more Western. But I used to learn and play some Carnatic line. That's why I'm able to do this.
So good, so good. Has there been a song all through the years that you've played with Sir, which has been extremely complex for you to crack it and play it? Challenged you the most, rather?
No, nothing I really want to know. Nothing. Nothing was challenging. Because enter the studio, so now you see him enter, he smiles. And what you bring, I'll be, yeah, of course, everybody has it. Not false, shall I say, fear or something. I mean, you're going to record, hope you are in shape, that our chops are in good shape. Yeah. So, what's going to be the lines I have to play? What's going to be the song?
Mm.
And to be honest, I'm little, when I get these odd time signatures, I get a little bit.
Okay.
I'm not used to them. Give me a 4-4, 2-4 any day, I'll do it. When this 5-8 and 7-8 come, I get a little bit. but and there's one correct, and this happened. So there was some indie song, I don't remember what the film name was. And eventually he said, Keith, this is not your meter.
Yeah.
He told me, that still made me feel a little happy. I know this is not your meter, but I want you to do something about this song. Feel like it's in 5, but you played out of the 7-8. But that was only, it was not a challenge because nothing happened by what I was playing. And he had like a guideline basis, play on this. I just wanted to keep the same thing.
Mm.
It's a little odd time, but you can, you'll do it, I know.
Mm.
Then I played this, I said, fine, very good.
Right.
So what I thought inward, I was just getting up, fixing my guitar up and connecting, thinking, my God, 5-8, 7-8, will be able to do this or what?
Yeah.
But then when he started playing, he's such a comfortable man to work with. And now he gets angry and smiles. I played it. So that was... But you want to know like a... not a challenge.
Mm.
I mean, I hope he doesn't mind me narrating this. He was doing this song for the... You know, the Taj Mahal was getting re-elected again into the 7 wonders of the world.
Yeah.
I think this was in 2007 or something. There was this... He did a song called Ek Mohabbate.
Correct.
That song, I went in and just said, you got 10 minutes to play this song. I said, what do you mean 10 minutes? You got to play this song running time. We have mixed it and I have to send it. I mean, some director was waiting for it to take it to the president
or the jury. Yeah, yeah.
We're going to listen to the song or something is happening. Because one guy was standing, I know someone was standing there with his hands folded, waiting to catch his flight. He said, don't stand in front of me. Just move that side. You were like in full tension. I had to walk in. Keith, save the song. The bass is sounding very weak. Come on, play. We have to play 10 minutes more. I'm already taking my guitar from my case. And he's... Then I said, okay. So I said, after you heard the song. Yeah, you heard it. Someone right here. So the play, I quickly had to write it down for the chord. And I played.
Yeah.
So it was one take.
Wow.
He said, yeah, exactly what you said. And he said, wow, sounding awesome. That's all. Not only was only the others, everything was just go take. I sometimes go in the afternoon, wait, he'll be mixing. Like I told you, he always calls me in the last stages.
Mixing stage.
Mixing stage. Bass not supporting the song. Okay, play it. Let's have live bass on it. So like that.
Nice.
That's why this example sounds good. Taj Mahal. He was already mixing it and sending it. That's to go. And then he's calling me.
Yes. Wow.
So that's what was very big, like we discussed earlier, was the shows.
Yeah.
Shows only were more hectic because the rehearsals and the long night rehearsals used to have before, at least 3 days before the show. Like, anywhere, it'd be Chennai or Bombay or Delhi or anywhere.
Yeah.
We'll, at least 3 or 4 days, we'll be on the stage rehearsing, like a full technical run through.
Yeah.
We'll go on the whole night. Only get to go home by next day, 6 in the morning. Catch a few hours rest again, come back for the next day's rehearsal.
Oof.
Till the show. And it'll be there, everybody be feeling sleepy and yawning. 3 in the morning, much easier. But that's it. You want to be in the bandwagon?
Correct, correct. And also what I wanted to ask you was, in the live shows, obviously, it doesn't necessarily have to stick with what's in the soundtrack. So you get very creative and the notations change and obviously there's a lot of things that changes, right? So so is that basically more of a creative discussion between the two of you, is it, when you get into the rehearsals mode?
Not to with everybody, because you have a whole band rehearsing. So it's a collective rehearsal. So everybody's there. And then when he comes, we would have rehearsed the song. But when Rahman comes in, and he may say, okay, let's do the song a little differently. Let's have an intro. So on spot, we did that. That is what is a long as rehearsal.
Right.
Like, say, from this afternoon till tomorrow morning.
Yappa.
With breaks and, of course, breaks, tea break, lunch break, dinner break.
Yeah.
Tea break. That setting up. The meaning of the guy will be setting up the stage on the side. Then we'll be rehearsing and then he'll change this song. Okay, you play an intro, you play a solo. That happens there.
Understand. So, does that happen as part of a jamming process? Not like saying, okay, this is how I need it. Sir doesn't probably say that. I'm just asking. I'm just trying to know.
Yeah, he says it. Sometimes he says, let's do the song this way.
Right.
Let's have a jamming impromptu.
Impromptu, yeah. That's the word.
Maybe between the singer and him.
Yeah.
Or any musician. Or he may say, Keith, okay, before this song, you play a small bass solo and get into the song.
Yeah.
That something happens on spot. Like, I remember what happened when you're playing us in Sydney. In Sydney, we were...
2010?
Yes.
I was there, in the front row, Parramatta.
Parramatta, yeah. Mustafa, that was, suddenly in the green room, he said, okay, you play a solo before Mustafa. Oh, not green room, 1-2 days before the rehearsal.
Huh.
I play something. Stephen Devasi, you play, Sanjeev, you play, Keith, you play.
Yeah.
Bring the song. So like that, all this happened.
Yeah. Wow.
Not as unpleasant.
Can you play a little bit of that, Keith, if you don't mind, of Mustafa?
Yeah, now you can hear it, no?
Yeah, better. Yeah.
Better. That's Mustafa line.
Right, wow. Right.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Well, that's it.
Great. And so also as part of your concert tours, you obviously would have had the opportunity to travel with him in the flights or wait in the lounge room and things like that. Any of those memories comes to your mind or eating with him? Anything?
Yeah, many times.
Yeah.
There was for the same movie.
Which one?
Mustafa, so Kadal Desam.
Kadal Desam,
The re-recording happened, and you wanted to do the re-recording in Bombay. So this, Rahman, myself, is engineer Sridhar, two other assistants, we've traveled to Bombay, and we did it at the college called XIZ, Xavier's College in Mumbai.
Yeah.
So it was good fun. 3 days of work, we're just recording some bits and parts. So we just got together to eat nice barathas and kurma. Then I was asking some questions about Mecca. Then that's the time he was going traveling to Mecca or something.
Yeah.
I was asking him what's the thing, what that means, that
yeah,
the thing they have in Mecca, no? Now you explain to me, Muhammad, the Prophet, or we.
Yeah.
Actually, you have to travel far away, get off the airport, take a bus and go far away. And all that. So all of the things. And also sometimes, yeah, one tour we were, I think it was 2007, some tour. There were different flights, but we were going to America only. But each, I mean, the flights were full, or the booking was done such a way that myself and the other bunch of musicians got to travel on a flight to Singapore Airlines, which flew Chennai, Korea, South Korea. Korea into LA.
Oh, wow.
Even this side, Ulta. So we had like 8 hour halt in Korea.
Yeah.
So we were all sitting and walking. Then he asked, can I buy you a coffee? It's all a bunch of musicians all over the talking and walking about this. Yeah, that was good fun.
Nice.
And everybody coming, clicking photos with him. He was shy. He'll just move away. Oh God, these guys are coming. Let's go. He doesn't like, you know.
He doesn't like attention.
That shy.
Yeah.
And media and all. Anyway, that's.
Yeah.
It was all good fun.
Indeed. And you mentioned about Sridhar. So I wish he was around, and I wish he had come on the podcast if he was around. What are the memories that comes to your mind, Keith?
But Sridhar, not. Sridhar, I knew before. Like how I knew Rahman.
Yeah.
Sridhar, I knew long time back. When I walked to Rahman studio one day, I mean, said that's what to do, this jingles and movie, I saw Sridhar there.
Right.
But I knew Sridhar before that, because Sridhar used to work. Yeah. I don't know if you know. You are from Chennai or?
I am from Bangalore.
And there used to be this music shop. I mean, those back in the days, I'm talking about the 80s.
Yeah.
When you wanted some foreign record, you couldn't get them.
Yeah.
There'll be one record which come out in some music guy shop, the guy will have it and he'll record it for you on a tape. You buy a tape and give some money and... Now that we have, I don't know if you call it bootlegging, the right word to use. But those guys only were able to get the records from Singapore or whatever. Nothing was available in India. Like you take a 80s album.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah, correct.
I don't know if the great composer like Quincy Jones and all. If they are like jazz album, like John McLaughlin and Shakti, you know.
Understand.
They were not freely available here.
Yeah.
So there used to be one guy in a store who used to work, get these albums, then you go and pay some money and give him a tape and buy a tape and he'll record. Sridhar used to be there.
Yeah.
Sridhar was working there. He loved music. So it was like, you're always into this recording stuff and all this thing. So that's why I knew Sridhar.
Yeah.
And then he was into Rahman studio. But yeah, he's very good.
Yeah.
He's a man with the sound. Of course, Rahman sit with him. But both of them sit together and do the mix.
Understand.
So whenever I used to go and play, both of these guys will be there.
Right.
And Sridhar being a musician, bass player.
Oh, he was too?
Yeah, he's a bass player. He's a bass.
Ah.
In his college days. And he knew quite sound in music. He knew some stuff about music.
Yeah.
So it used to be fun sometimes. He'll suggest some line. Why don't you play this season? I must just let him play what he's playing.
Wow.
And sometimes if Rahman won't be, they'll say, okay, I know what. See the rest record him. I'm going.
Right.
I got some other work. See then me like we'll have fun. He'll say, play this illustration. Be quiet. I'll play what they want to play. He'll suggest a maybe jazz line. This is film music, boss. This,
yeah.
Keep it jazz aside.
Yeah.
But that's the experience with it. I mean, no, see the song. I mean,
it must have hit you pretty hard when he left.
Right. Yeah. Shocking. Because a week before I had recorded them.
Oh, yeah.
That movie, it was Yuvraj.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay.
So, Yuvraj and also that Amir Khan movie, Gajani.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah, correct. Correct.
Between those two film years, working. I recorded a song next week after I get a call from my friend saying Sridhar passed away. I said, oh God.
Wow.
Anyway.
Yeah.
It's quite sad.
Indeed.
Recently, another guy too passed away, no? Great musician in Rahman group, guy called Chinu.
Ah, yeah, I heard about that. Yes, yes.
He used to play all the mandolin parts.
Correct.
Chinachinasana was this guy only.
Yeah, yeah. Indeed, indeed.
Anyway.
What I wanted to ask you was, it's a huge loss, no doubt about it. Sridhar sir's departure, and the whole community was really shocked when he passed away. But the thing is, the legacy that he has left with all the body of work with yourselves and sir and the entire team, especially with the mixing and everything else that he's been doing. One of the things that obviously stands out is obviously the quality of sound that came out of the studio. And I remember when Bharat Bala sir, which I'm sure you know, was on the podcast as well sometime last year. And he said, sir, that is AR sir, had a vision saying when a song comes out of the studio, it should sound like Michael Jackson's song. It should be crystal clear. So I'm just curious to know what sort of, the efforts that Sridhar sir had to put in to get that kind of output. Has he narrated anything of those sorts? The reason why I'm asking you is obviously because he's not around, but you've been there with him while he was around. And is there anything that he has narrated with you, or you have seen him do something which has created that magic?
Yeah, I told you, I was fortunate enough sometimes to do the song at his mixing stage.
Correct.
So I used to see what's happening. Sridhar and Rahman together sitting, I'll be playing. Yeah. Then he'll be doing a small mix. All the distraction. That's all. But then I play and go. After that, their major thing, they finally mix it down and finish it. But when they found it weak, also every recording of mine until Sridhar passed away was always Sridhar, Rahman, myself.
Oh yeah, wow.
Yeah, because I always play towards it. Well, again, I'm repeating the same thing. This mixing stage of the song, he'll call me for bass.
Yeah.
Or sometimes even Sridhar will call me. Rahman won't call.
Mm.
Of course, the manager will call me, but Sridhar will say, call Keith. Then, tell me, oh, Keith, they'll say, yeah, sir, Kupra, wow, sikram. It'll be some 10:30, I'll just be retiring to go to bed or something, 11 o'clock. What never so, wow. Oh, God. I tell my wife, say, go, I'll see you in the morning, she'll say.
Wow.
Sridhar will come, grandpa. He'll talk the dangling day. Come on, grandpa, let's connect, record, play, let's do something. Rahman, what's happening? He called me to come and play. Okay, play. Then they'll be discussing some terms that I don't know.
Yeah.
Mixing. Put a compressor there, put this here, see, they'll do this. Okay, come on, Keith, play. But I would have finished.
Yeah.
But then it'll be some hours in the morning. It'll be some 4 or 5. Those days, I mean, the earlier 91, 92, no cell phone, no Ola, no. Come out, I said, I'll tell the boys. Say, boys, I'm going to crash out here. Because I'll go in the morning. Yeah. Then fly down, sleep. Then I'll just go off there. They'll be mixing somewhere. I'll go sleep in the other. So that after the work used to happen. See the... Sometimes he'll drop me in the night.
Huh.
See the... He used to live by my house. Too.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I say, tough man. I have to go do this mix. Not only are you talking about Rahman, you know, big demand. He used to work a lot for music directors. Right?
Yeah.
A lot of guys. Already wanted him because he had the sound.
Yeah. Yeah.
His work. So he used to go there. Tomorrow I must go there. I have to mix here. I'll have to mix there. That was only narration to me. Like,
right.
God, I've got to finish this mix. I've got to finish that mix. Got to go there. Come back, mix. Finish Rahman sir's mix and this and that.
Right.
That was my experience with it.
Very nice. And also the fact that you've worked with AR, so you've worked with all the other music directors, almost everyone, and was so comfortable with you going out and working with them,
Oh yeah,
the
very, very,
others.
very, very,
Right. Right.
yeah. That's okay. I won't mention names for some reason. Anyway, I was playing. Then I said, "This guy's calling me to play. Yeah, go and play. You should play everywhere. Everybody should know you. Eh? Go and play." So, but that guy's not comfortable with me going out. He's mad. You just go and play. Don't worry. You should play for everyone.
Right. And now when you go out and play for the other music directors, of course I'm not picking any names here, but they will always be very curious about how you went about playing for, let's say, Kalluri Salai from Kadal Desam. You killed
Right.
it. And they must have been so inspired about that. I'm just taking this as an example, that's all.
Yeah.
And they would have asked you, how did you go about playing? And does that come into the spot where it becomes more like a trade secret and you don't want to give it away or underplay
No, they not like that. They won't ask me how you got to play that. They'll say play like that.
Yeah, okay.
They'll refer some song you played, no? But most reference was this. Snake. A lot of other guys who came and said, "Play, I want that same feel how you play." That's all they say. They won't say how you play that. Play like that.
Right.
Or play like this.
Yeah.
They'll just give a reference.
Understand. Understand.
Yeah, that's all, nothing else.
Right. Yeah. And maybe on that note, Snehidane, just maybe a couple of seconds.
Yeah, I did some slapping in between there, no? So some lines are snake in there.
Very nice. And all.
She wanted Carlo Isale.
Wow, I love this. I love this. What was the brief he gave you for Kalluri Salai? Because this Kalluri Salai is a very, very addictive track for me. And I'm just curious, like, what was the brief or the discussions that you had prior to this song?
Nothing, no, that's play, he said. That was also like a synth line.
Huh.
He wanted something fat over it.
Right. Wow.
All
And
that.
there's another track of yours which I am dying to ask you memories about, Kadal Sadgudu. I love that track and the way it starts, it just blows my mind all the time. And the best part is, of course, you would agree with me, that track is still so fresh and relevant even today, after so many years. And that's the same thing even with Roja or right from those days. Thoughts on Kadal Sadgudu? What memories comes to you?
This line was a guitar line he had got there then already previously. So he said, "Play that riff, play that first." So I played it. And now the song kept playing, and he let me play what I wanted to play. So I kept trying this song. All it.
Love it, love it, love it. And
That was also, I mean, I got little, it was little, I mean, what shall I say? After I heard it, was scary. I said, "How did I play this?" That was a snake in it. Two songs we did together. Together means, I mean, one night he said, "Do this. Okay, come tomorrow, we'll do another song, Snake in it." And both the songs were just one take. He said, "Yeah, you finished. You're done."
Wow.
I myself didn't know. Then later on, I went for some of the recording of his. And I asked him, "Oh, the songs are okay, come out. The CD is released." "Yeah, it's released. Did you hear them? It's sounding great." Trousers too. So yeah, very great. Good stuff. Good nice. Playing, he said. Yeah, thanks.
Nice. And one of the albums that was so futuristic when it came out back then, Trida Trida, it is still so futuristic, relevant, and it rocks the music systems even today. And I'm sure that must be bringing memories to you. Obviously, you've been part of that.
Yeah. Kannum kannum kollai edithal.
So
that was a tricky one. Yeah. That was the bass line going through. Again, that was a synth line, but he made me play on top of it.
Wow.
Yeah, all the drums. There's also a kind of a running bass there. All that was there.
Right. And you obviously played for Rangila as well. And that's a killer track.
Yeah.
Wow. What memories does this bring you?
that was the first indie track, correct? Like, right, what you're asking.
Correct.
Oh, indie, and this guy was there also in the studio when I was playing Ram Gopal Varma.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I mean, this is Keith Peters, bass player, plays for me. That guy's got his hands folded and said, oh, okay. Then he said, play this track. So I played, yeah, that was nice.
Yeah.
No, man, it's like, for me, it was just another song. But then I go, oh, it's an indie song. Oh, good. Then came Bombay.
Yeah.
The thing was a great thing. Like, whatever he came out with was like a real bang in the film industry, no?
Indeed, of course.
From Roja, came Bombay, then Rangila, then Chaya Chaya, Uyire, Dilse.
Yeah, Dilse.
That was another major big thing.
Indeed.
Yeah, I played on Chaya Chaya. So great.
And you also played in Indian Akada.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite songs.
I love it.
Even today, I play all these songs, Keith. I mean, it just gives me so much happiness whenever I listen to all these tracks. And the best part is, I think you played in almost all the songs that are there on my playlist. And you're being so humble about it. And then, how do you feel whenever you listen to a track that you've played? I mean, of course, I'm sure you'll be playing the songs that you have performed in it, right? At home?
Yeah, correct.
So how do you feel when, let's say, when Kalluri Salai plays on your music system? Like, how do you feel when you hear the track that, hey, I've actually performed in it? Just trying to get your thoughts on what does it feel like?
Well, yeah, what, I know what. Nothing to say. I said, okay, good, I played. I thank God for giving me the talent.
Wow.
We're able to play.
Yeah.
So now people reach out to it and listen to it. And even they talk about Badat Sarugudu, and everybody says iconic bass line.
Correct.
They tell me, only you played, I said, I thank God for it. God has given the talent and I've used it.
Yeah.
I've played it.
And when the songs play, do you get picky on it, thinking, I could have played this part better? Anything of that sort at all?
No. I listen to what it is, that's all.
Right.
And I played it.
You don't judge it?
Maybe. No, I don't judge it. Because it's coming out from the master himself. He has judged it. It's his song. And maybe if it was my song and I'm doing something, I may be a little picky. I don't do.
Yeah.
So I take it as he's called me to play and he wants me to give it my best. I've given it to him. He's liked it.
Right.
But sometimes during the day, he'll ask me, is it right? Sounding night, you're okay with it? Everything's fine. I said, yeah.
And just coming towards the end of the podcast now, and then just a couple of more things before I let you go. I'm sure you would agree with me that AR sir has a very, very good sense of humor. And he spontaneously cracks jokes. And I'm just curious to know if anything comes to your mind that he must have cracked and you guys must have laughed.
Yeah, there's so many things. remember, like, Sridhar and myself were there doing this Rangila time only. One of the guys from Ram Gopal Varma's company had come and said, sir, what's sir? Wants a song. What o'clock can I come? You mean what? So Rama just looked at him and said, what o'clock? Come any clock, but before 2 o'clock. I mean, we all three knew it and we all laughed to ourselves. After he said, okay, and he went out. But the way he answered, what o'clock, any clock, but before 2 o'clock. Don't come before 2 o'clock. Come what o'clock you want. That guy, he said, okay, sir, okay, sir. He's one of the boys working in the company.
Oh my god, okay.
That day he cracks him. Too late, he calls him guy too late. The guy can't get anything. Too late, too late.
Love it.
He got me. This is me some. There is a great, I mean, band called Emerson, Lake and Palmer. I don't know, you must have heard of.
Okay.
You must have heard about that band, Emerson, Lake and Palmer. They're an international band.
Right. I'm probably not across.
Yeah. He is also a big fan of that band. They're called Emerson, Lake and Palmer.
Right.
EMERSON. They're all their surnames. They go by their surnames.
Yeah.
And I think the keyboard player was Keith Emerson. Keith
right.
Emerson.
Right.
So when he comes and say, come, Keith Emerson. Say, Keith. Say, yeah.
That. Right. Very nice.
Good humor, dear sir.
So towards the end of the podcast, Keith, and then so just wondering, as part of this podcast journey, obviously I'm doing this as a tribute to AR sir, with almost everyone I've covered, and I wish Sridhar sir was also there. But however, as part of this podcast, I would like you to please give a message for AR sir in this podcast, and I will share this little clip over to him so that he sees it. Any message you want to give to sir?
To Dr. Rahman, as he is now. I wish him all the best in his future musical endeavors. And always wish him, and God bless his talent. He's still giving a lot of great music to all the people around.
Yeah.
I'm also grateful to him for using me on all his tracks and touring with him throughout the world. I've seen the world through him.
Wow.
Of course, through God's blessings, but he's a man I shared all his glory. I was happy to share his glory too. And God bless him.
So beautiful. And maybe something you can perform, maybe for a couple of seconds, as a little dedication to sir. Anything you want. So beautiful.
A bit of Dil Se.
Absolutely. I absolutely love it. Keith, I tried to capture or touch on every topic that I had thought of. Is there anything that I may not have touched and you would like to talk about before I let you go?
One tour I would like to mention, which is a very great tour for me. Grandma, next film. After he had won the Oscars, 2009. 2010, there was a big tour he did in America.
Correct. That one I know.
And that I'm also very grateful to him because it was so great of him, because those guys, American guys, wanted all their musicians to play.
Huh.
It was all American. They even also wanted their bass player, an American bass player.
Yeah.
He says, no, I'll bring Keith. because Keith has played in all my tracks.
Love it.
So then yeah, that's also a great tour. I mean, so much of music. We toured, we rehearsed for months and with this foreign artists.
Yeah.
They always thought Indian, they all put them, they just put us down.
Yeah.
But then when we, so he took myself and Naveen.
Yeah. Flute Naveen.
Dude.
Yeah.
They were zapped with us.
Amazing.
He was also, yeah. That was a very great tour, I'd like to mention. That's all.
So beautiful. So beautiful. So Keith, before I let you go, let's take an e-selfie. And you can stay as you are. And you can, you just have to look at the camera. And at the count of three, you can smile and I'll take a picture here.
Yeah.
And so there are two pictures. One is a normal picture like you are, like the way you are. And the second picture is you have to make a funny face. You can do anything you want. So the first picture, at the count of three. One, two, three. Now. Second picture, count of three.
Funny face.
You can make any funny face. Yeah, that's it. I love it. So, and lastly, something that I've not done before, but I want to do it with you. I'll play a track here, Keith. And it'll play from my speaker, it'll come via my mic. And you can do any dance step you want while you're seated. And that'll go only for 2 or 3 seconds, that's all. Just amazing.